Welcome back. We are still continuing our conversation with Dr. Olivia Nabawanda, a graduate, a PhD graduate in the field of mathematics, and the first at her age, that was 31, that was last year. And still 31? When do we celebrate the next year? No, eh? Okay, we don't ask ladies about their ages, so let's just keep it. Or maybe it's forever 16, who knows? Anyway, so forever 31, yes. So, doctor, we have talked about the journey, what inspired you into the field of math, and how you found yourself managing in primary level. I think we've talked mostly about the primary level. So what was it like in secondary? Did the interest continue, or was it that you were pushed to ensure that you keep that interest, you know, going? Because now you had picked interest. So even if it was dying, maybe somebody was walking you that journey to ensure that you don't lose interest in mathematics. I don't know. Maybe my assumption is wrong. You could tell me what really happened in secondary level.
Mm. Okay. So having picked interest in mathematics during my primary, like, you know, the beauty of mathematics, sometimes when you have a question to solve and then you get an answer, you can always test your answer and see whether it's correct or wrong. Eh? So for me as a student, I used to look forward to which kind of answer am I going to get? And then I would look forward to testing it and see whether it's actually the correct answer. So that interest was sustained even throughout my secondary education. Yes, I used to enjoy mathematics a lot. All levels, senior one, senior two, up to senior four, and I performed really well. And then after senior four, I decided to continue with mathematics at A level. Yes, so A level I did mathematics, and then physics, of course, physics is also mathematics. Yes, yes, yeah. Chemistry and biology. Wow. That time we were doing four.
So that was physics, chemistry, biology,
PCB,
and math.
Yes.
Wow. That is some brain. Not some in Kayunga, you can imagine. Not even like, what are those schools? Gayaza, Namagunga. Those are the schools you think girls
yes,
would be doing
and
PCB.
The, trust Not me, some, mm. yeah, it wasn't an easy decision to make. You know, like with a, there was a lot of negativity from people that if you're going to do the subjects at the same school, then you may never pass. Yeah, so if you want to do PCB mathematics, then you need to go to some other school, those nice schools. Yes, but for me, like my parents could not afford taking me to any other school. And first of all, that was a school around home. Yes, so just like any parent, you would want your children to be around you. Especially my dad, he was tough when it comes to his children. He always wanted us around home. He wanted to see us often. Yes, so, but I went for it. PCB mathematics, I just told myself, I passed these subjects at all level. And the teachers who are teaching me, they won't be the same teachers I'm going to be around even during these 2 years of A level. So I was like, no, I'm not going to listen to any negativity. I'll just go and try my best. So I started senior five, PCB mathematics. First term was not all that smooth. Yes.
What happened?
I remember the very first test I did in mathematics, I had, I think, 40%.
Way below the pass mark.
Yes. I was not happy. So I was like, no. This is not me. Yes, I was used to getting at least 70 and above. So I had to sit down. That's when I got to know that A level is not a walk in the park. So if you want to get good grades, then you have to sit down, focus and read. So I remember we used to have two textbooks, Backhouse 1 and Backhouse 2 for mathematics. I remember, I think I'd not understood certain concepts from class, and had not labored to go ahead and ask for explanations, maybe from friends or even my teachers. So after seeing my mark, I was not happy. I went back to my room, and then I was like, I have to read this topic and understand it. I remember that topic was trigonometry. It's a very wide topic and a bit tricky with several properties which you must know. So I went and got this textbook, and I told myself I have to read from the first page of this topic until at least I get something. And trust me, by the end, I sat, I think, for around 3 hours. At the end of those 3 hours, I was good to go. I'd understood. I was like, wow. And I went back to the questions which had been set, and then I tried them out, and the answers were coming out. So that kind of gave me an inspiration. I was motivated that, okay, that means I can actually read on my own and understand. Sometimes the teacher will come to class, and then you can't understand everything from class. But when you go back and now also try to go through again, read more, maybe textbooks, like concepts get more and more clear. So that's what happened. And from that time, I never looked back. Now the mathematics of O-level started again, flowing very well. Everything was now moving on smoothly, though not with hard work, not just sitting there and say,
thinking everything will be okay. You had to work for those
marks.
Did you have to stay up all night, like read, burn the midnight
personally
candle?
Personally, me, I'm a nocturnal person. I prefer reading like in the evenings, up to say like midnight. Then after that, I want sleep until morning. And so I used to read. I read. First of all, I had these other subjects. Mathematics alone has only 2 papers, paper 1 and paper 2. But the other subjects I had 3 papers. So which means you had to really schedule your reading very well in order to balance like all the subjects. But for when it came to mathematics, on my reading timetable, I actually used not to include it. I made math part of me. Like when you're maybe tired, that's when I would now think about some mathematics numbers. You just sit there and then be trying out some questions.
So you didn't get any support from the teachers. I mean, you're doing the reading on your own. Did you cross over?
Yes, very well. My teachers too were very supportive. And learning becomes interesting when you know that the teacher knows you. Especially by name. Okay, that's a very trick, and I use it often when I'm teaching. I make sure I get to know my learners by their names. When they know that you know them, this is the way they feel. Nice. It's a nice feeling, and they'll try to work hard and make sure that they don't disappoint you. So that was my experience as well. Yes, my teachers knew. They knew I was capable of performing. Yes, so they were still very supportive. I remember one of my teachers, Mr. Katavira Paul. I don't know where he is now. Maybe he's right now at Bishop Senior School, Mukono. Whenever he would be leaving class, he would put a question on board, and then he would ask me to go and try out. So that also like made me have confidence in myself that, okay, I can. I can. Why is he choosing me all the time to go and try this and this and this? So it kind of built my confidence. And he was not the only one. There were several other mathematics teachers. And others were university students. Like they had competed from my school. And then they used to come from university to come and like revise with us. So they also inspired me a lot.
Interesting. So I remember when we were having our conversation earlier on, you told me math was really not what you were interested in. But fast forward, here we are now, you're in A-level and you've chosen to do math. This is like now the future, because it was going to shape what you were going to be as a professional. So at that point, what did you think you were going to do after the O level? What profession did you think you were going to, you know, pursue after your A level?
Actually, the truth is, after O level, I didn't really have a specific like profession in mind. To take you back, when I was in primary, I wanted to be a headmistress because my head teacher was a headmistress and I used to admire her a lot. But when I went to secondary, then I forgot about her. But I was just studying, like, I don't think I had any profession in mind. But of course, during those times, the most common or trending professions were a doctor, an engineer, a lawyer, and so on. So as you study, of course, you also want to become one, but I didn't really have a particular one. But when I went for, when I went to, joined A-level with PCB mathematics, of course, biology, chemistry, that means you can go for any, for a medical course. Okay, so in my mind, I knew that if I pass, then I can join any medical course. And the course I wanted, the course I really wanted was pharmacy. I wanted to do pharmacy at the university. Yes. And in order for you to qualify pharmacy, then you must make sure that biology and chemistry are well catered for. You've passed very well. So
did you pass?
Yes, I passed.
What was the score at A level for all these subjects? Because they're all tough subjects.
Yes, I had, at least for mathematics, I had an A, 1-1 in both papers. Then physics, I had a B. Chemistry, I had a C. Biology, I had a D.
A D in biology. Yeah. So would it take you for pharmacy?
It would take me for pharmacy on private, but not on government, yes.
So what happened now that you were not going to go anywhere for pharmacy in on a government sponsorship?
Of course, when we finished like UNAB, usually filled those forms, the job forms, open job forms. Yes, and there are always 5 choices to make. Of course, my first choice was medicine, good university, but deep inside my heart, I knew, okay, if they give it to me, well and good, but this is not really what I want. Then I put pharmacy around 3rd choice, engineering 4, 5, and then Bachelor of Science in Education was the last choice. And I put education with the teaching subjects as mathematics and physics. And remember, this is where I had an A and a B. So definitely there was no way I was going to miss being given education and then get a medical course where I had C and D. So when the results came back for the government lists and so on, I'd been given a Duke education, Barra University of Science and Technology, physics and mathematics.
Of course not.
Yes, I wasn't happy. You know, like those days, like, people discourage, like, you know, being
Who
a teacher.
Who are these people? Because they discourage you from physics, from math, from the choices you made. Then here they are again discouraging.
They can be colleagues, like your friends. And now you see, being a teacher, and all these people are suffering. There's no money in education. So you're going to be poor for the rest of your life, blah, blah, blah. You know, such stuff. Right. So because of that, in my heart, I wasn't happy. But on the other hand, I was happy because I was going to join the university. Actually, when the results came back, I remember some of my teachers tried to get in touch with my dad, and then they tried to convince him to at least try and pay for me at the university on private so that I can go for a medical course. But my dad, I think, actually, at some point, he seemed to have borrowed the idea. He seemed to be in agreement with them. And then he came back home and told me, your teachers are telling me A, B, C, D, so shall see what to do. So even went and got the application forms from Makerere University. But towards reporting time, I think around July, you know, the semester you start around August, the academic new academic years for the university, around from August onwards, yeah. So around July now, my dad comes and tells me, you know what, Olivia, I think it's better for you not to miss this opportunity of being on a government scholarship. You go and do education. By the time you finish, maybe the salaries will be better. I remember that time he told me, maybe by the time you finish, you'll be getting around 800,000. So probably by the time we sat our exams, maybe teachers around that time were getting around 500. So to him, 800 was...
would be good.
Yes, it is some good amount of money. So that you just go and do education. But my teachers really wanted me to...
Do medicine
or at least any medical course, but not education. Yeah, so they would tell you, we don't want you to be like us. We are struggling so much. We want you to be better. The point that even when I joined the university, they still had to get in touch with some administrators there and trying to inquire from them whether it's possible for me to
change
the course, but it wasn't possible. And if I was to change, that would mean that I had to be on private,
yes. Which was not about to happen.
Which was not about to happen because the person who would give me money
had refused. Go do the education. You'll get 800,000 in salary, which is good.
Anyway, we shall take a break, Dr. Olivia. When we come back, you tell us more about how this journey went for you from getting that Bachelor of Education, which your dad said you should actually do because maybe you'd get more money than other teachers than what they were getting at that time. Yeah, so we'll take a break. When we come back, we'll pick it from there as we talk to Dr. Olivia Nabawanda, who is an icon in the field of mathematics here in Uganda, and I bet in Africa too, and worldwide, because you're not too many. You're many, but not too many. So we'll be back.